There's no such thing as the archetypal footballer, no such thing as the ideal shape or size. The professional game demands a range of talents. There are the gifted, the powerful, the brave, the tricky, and the sly. And there are those who offer a combination of these things, along with the ability to dominate physically at the intensely competitive top level, the hard men. Believe me, football fans can derive as much pleasure from seeing an uncompromising tough nut strutting his stuff as they can from watching the sublimely talented. But what makes these men a breed apart? What makes them kick? Your guide to the men of grit and guile is today's self-confessed creator of havoc, Vinnie Jones.
I mean, what is hard? Is hard not flinching in a tackle? I think that's what it means. If the ball's there to be won, and you've got to go in to win that ball for your team, and maybe you are going to be in a 40-60 situation, and you've still got to go in. And I think that's what all I think that's what these lads in this video are all about.
Number one tough nut, the supremely competitive Graham Souness. Hard to believe that he ran away from Tottenham in his teens because he was homesick. But he won his Spurs at Anfield in the late 70s and early 80s.
Yeah, Graham Souness, I've got a lot of admiration for him because I think he was a very passionate player and he looked after other players as well. If one of his players got a whack or something, you know, untoward went on, whereas one of his players got hurt, he would go and sort it out for them. I'm not saying that's right, but he took it upon himself to say, you're not taking liberties with any of my lads, you know? And he was out there and he captained them and all sorts of things and played for Scotland, scored some brilliant goals.
Three players to his right, he's picked out Souness, who picks out a beauty!
Great pass with the ball.
Dead right, Vinny. So much of Souness's driving talent in midfield produced something positive for the likes of Kenny Dalglish and Ian Rush. The telling pass and the clinical finish, the trademark of Liverpool at their best.
I don't think Graham Souness was a 40-60 man. I think he used to turn it round and make it 40-60 in the other way. But I've seen a few of his tackles like against a couple of Germans and Denmark and things like that, and he has had a tendency to go very high when he goes in for the ball. But, you know, a lot of admiration for him. And even now as a manager, he's still, you know, very passionate about it.
Get after him now!
And I do like to look up to people like that.
There are all sorts of tackles. Some you get just right, that's called reading the game. Sometimes you're a bit late, that's called clumsy. And then there are those that just go horribly wrong. A bit like this.
Keegan. Oh, that was a bit late on Kevin Keegan by Graham Souness. And the referee wants a word. And Keegan limping away. And Souness, who has been known to make the first tackle tell, gets a ticking off.
If you win things, you get bonuses, you get paid more. I play to win. I don't regard myself as a hard man, no.
Well, there are plenty of footballers still nursing the bruises to prove you wrong there, Graham. Plenty to admire too, though.
Liverpool were rather square, and money was the extra man. Good challenge by Souness.
Souness was a great player. Everything went through him. He was a player who demanded the ball, got it from the back players, gave it to the front players. And of course, he could win a tackle. He was a ferocious competitor. But a great captain, Graham, you know, led by example, got everybody playing. And some of the best football I ever saw from Liverpool teams were when Graham Souness was in the side.
Souness! brilliant goal. His first for Liverpool. It's going to fall for Souness, and Liverpool have got five players in attack here. Souness into the gap. Beautifully done. A goal by Souness. Anyway, three to come onto the angled one. Souness! Oh, I say! What a way to complete a hat-trick! He never saw it!
So, Graham Souness at his peak was unquestionably tough, certainly uncompromising, and he never shirked a challenge. Although some of those challenges, it would be fair to say, didn't exactly endear him to opposing fans. Mostly, his quality shone through. With Souness, it was outstanding talent, allied to a ferocious desire to win. Liverpool's unprecedented and unsurpassed run of success coincided with his time at Anfield. His attitude was a key element of the Reds' reign, and the odd conversation with the referee was all part of a day's work for Souness. Over 200 league games for Liverpool, and a driving force in every one of them. Scotland too benefited from his endeavours on 54 occasions, and the one thing we'll remember about Graham Souness is that he was always a winner, so often taking the silverware back to the sideboard at Anfield. Five league championship medals at Liverpool alone before further glory as player and manager with Rangers in Scotland.
I think a lot of the hard men in football, it's all down to their characters. You know, they're not just aggressive on the field, they're probably aggressive in every walks of life. You know, whether it's, you know, have an argument with a baker or have an argument with, you know, Tommy Smith or with the manager, you know. I think all these lads have been, I think they're always saying to themselves, you know, I'm not going to be pushed about. I'm going to have my piece. And then when you go out on a football field and you can do something about it, I think, you know, you've got 25, 30, 40,000 people watching you. And I think a lot of clubs, a lot of supporters, they look for that because they all want to be leaders themselves. I think everyone in the crowd, if there's 30,000 there, 30,000 people want to be leaders. They want to be the boss, you know. They don't want to be the tea boy.
Billy Bremner, captain and inspiration of Don Revie's Leeds side in the 60s and early 70s, is hard man number two. Like Vinnie Jones, a hero at Elland Road.
Yeah, obviously, a long time before I came into football, but being a player at Elland Road myself, you can still feel like the buzz of the bloke sort of 20 years on or 15 years on. People still talk about Billy Bremner as, you know, where are we going to put his statue in Leeds? What he done for us, you know? It wasn't just... He never just led Leeds United Football Club. I think he led the people at work, the people at home. They looked up to him. He was their leader. He was, you know, because in Leeds, football is life and death. You know, I mean, that's how I look upon football anyway. You know, there's nothing else. Well, there's money and there's football. If you haven't got money, you've got nothing. If I haven't got football, I haven't got nothing. Billy Bremner, as I say, he inspired people at work, in the factories, you know, right down to like very, very big and influential players at the time. And he was only a wee man, you know? Someone said to me once in Leeds, he was, you know, sort of 4.5 foot tall, but when he was out on the pitch, the way he went about and his mannerism, you'd think he was 10 foot tall. And I think that's very important.
Bremner played at the highest level for a sustained period of time and knew how to look after himself in the harshest of environments. The 1973 FA Cup final at Wembley against second division Sunderland isn't recalled in Leeds with too many fond memories. and Bremner had a tough tussle in midfield with the Sunderland goal-scoring hero that afternoon, Ian Porterfield. Bremner was never a player who'd come off second best very often, and he's proof that all great sides need some bite at the centre. Leeds' most productive seasons revolved around captain Bremner, and two examples here of how players of his ilk must be prepared to live and die by the sword. First, some rough stuff at Wembley against Liverpool, and then in 1972 against another red-haired midfield terrier, Alan Ball. Evidence that those with a reputation for midfield durability are often the target for their own type of medicine.
The only thing is, I think, if you're going to dish it out, you've got to be expected to take it back. You know, the little ones like treading on people's toes in the box and things like that. I mean, if you do that, you've got to expect a clump. As that ball's in the air and everyone's watching the ball, you've got to expect that lad to give you a clump, you know? Unless you're very cute and, you know, you're ducking and diving and that's part of your game.
The success of the Leeds squad throughout the 60s and 70s all came under Bremner's captaincy and the management of the late Don Reavy. He knew Bremner's qualities better than anyone.
He was quick, over 10 yards. He could see things out the back of his head. He could cut balls between people. He could lift games out of nothing. He could play 1-2s and set things off, and then you'd see him tackling back if he made a mistake or anybody else made a mistake. And he was one of the world's greatest players.
O'Grady. Jack Charlton. Bremner. Oh, beautiful goal! What a superlative goal by Bremner! Oh, what a wonderful goal by Bremner! Madeley back to Lorimer. And Bremner! It's there! Bodies, Bremner finds the only hole.
Bremner on the field as a captain brings back visions of the Mackays and people long before that. He's the best captain the game's produced for 10 years. He's a better captain than Revie is a manager. Mm. And it can be argued that Don Revie is the best manager in the Football League. He is doing on the field what Don Revie does 7 days a week. And when they trot out in that out of that tunnel on a Saturday, Billy's just carrying it on.
There could be no higher praise than that from old Big Ed himself, who arrived at Elland Road for his short spell, just as Bremner's 17 years of fierce commitment to the Leeds cause was drawing to a close. In total, just under 600 league games throughout the most illustrious seasons in Leeds history. Years of confrontation at the very highest level, and years peppered with top-class achievement.
Osgood. Houseman and Bremner. Bremner, what a player.
Yes, Billy Bremner, the second of our hard men, who grew accustomed to holding the odd trophy or two, and like Graham Souness, another whose list of triumphs makes impressive reading.
I think that the players that we're looking at in this video, I think there's only one or two that haven't made international level. So, you know, it does show you that the English football and Scottish football relies very heavily on a tough lad that's gonna say his piece on the field, say his piece in the dressing room. And I think the main ingredient that you need is to be like have your respect from your other teammates.
Nobby Styles of Manchester United and England, a World Cup winner in 1966, is the next candidate in our anthology of hard men.
Yeah, Nobby Styles, I mean, he's he could have been a cartoon character, couldn't he? You know, he was football's equivalent to Popeye, you know? Can of spinach before the game, go out there. A little weedy-looking man with glasses and no teeth. And when he walked on that football field, you'd think it was Goliath coming on there. You know, same again, I think. You know, he had a no-holes-barred character. You know, he knew that he weren't a good-looking lad and he weren't going to be a model and all the rest of it. But he got all his credibility out of sorting people out on the field. And when, I mean, you come to it, like people like Jack Charlton, people like that, that played around him, you know, and the England side, when they won it, the World Cup, it's, you know, I've got to take me out after him, and, you know, he's like my cartoon character.
Nobby Styles obviously took the nation took him to heart because of the infectious smile without his front teeth. And the fact that he thought he was never beaten, and he never was beaten. And everybody else used to gee him up, and everybody else used to get him to do this type of thing and that type of thing, and he just rubbed off on everybody else. Everybody sometime in life, whether it be a cup final or whether it be a tournament or whether it be in life generally over a period of time, want to have around them a Nobby Styles. Cause they're good for you.
Nobby Styles, the young white half. Going through on his own now with a great chance. Styles is there, he drives it! What a goal! There's Nobby Styles. Defensive wing halfback for Manchester United and attacking wing halfback for England. All comes alike to Nobby Styles. And any and another goal by Nobby Styles. And this might well be the next one. There's Styles onto it now. Can he get a shot in? He gets a shot in.
The great names in Manchester United history will forever be Law, Best and Charlton. Perhaps a little unfairly when you consider the abilities of those around them, particularly Styles, who played his part to the full in those heady days at Old Trafford in the 60s.
I think he was a magnificent influence in the Manchester United team. I think if you looked at the best ever Manchester United team, it didn't have Nobby. There may have been something missing. You couldn't visualise a great Manchester United team out there without those snarling fangs of his, you know? And not just that, but, I mean, he could play. I remember asking Sir Alf Ramsey once about his 1966 World Cup team. He says he had five world-class players, and Nobby was one of them. A great read of the game, what Bobby Charlton always mentions, that a marvellous read of the game. Influenced the team, could tackle, could pass.
Styles getting it in and a hurt, and he's onside, and that's the second one. A brilliant piece of quick thinking there by Styles, really, that they are congratulating. Hurd was the scorer with a very fine assist by Styles, the left half.
We were a sort of mixture of everything. We had a mixture of guile, we had a mixture of class, goal scorers, and people who could... A little Nobby.
Who was that?
Occasionally, Nobby would... you know, put a little bit of stuff.
If required.
So we had to have a championship side, you really have got to have a mixture of all that, and we did have it.
Styles played his part too on that emotional night in May 1968 when Manchester United finally lifted the European Cup at Wembley, 2 years after he'd been an integral member of Sir Alf Ramsey's World Cup winning 11. The name of Styles will always be etched into English football history. Although he made comparatively few appearances for his country, just 28 in all. However, those 28 caps, all between 1965 and 1970, coincided with a happy period for the national team and were characterised by the kind of aggression and tenacity that were his trademark. But Bobby Charlton also argued that Styles had far more subtlety than he was ever given credit for. Nobby was once described as the symbol of Sir Alf's determination to win.
And I've always inferred that Nobby Styles always played the ball. And you saw this today, in as much that Nobby Styles is a great player. And I'm proud that he is an Englishman, and I'm proud that he was in the England team.
Like all footballers, though, there were moments when his timing was awry. But Styles' commitment to the England cause was never called into question, except for one particular tackle during the 1966 World Cup, which caused howls of protest from the foreign press. It came in the third match against France, and the unlucky victim, the Frenchman Jacques Simon.
It was a bad tackle. I felt that Simon was a good player. and the conditions were a bit slippy. And what I used to do sometimes, I would sort of pull away and look as though I wasn't interested and invite people to play the ball to people, and then I'd be over the ground, because I was quite quick over 10, 15 yards. And I always tried to catch him just on the turn and then tackle the ball and hit the ball and take it on. And then you got them looking for you as well, and they started to jump a little bit. I don't mean just going and kicking them up in the air. And I went for the tackle, and it was slippy, and he was a good player. And I was committed, and he'd knocked it, and I couldn't stop, and I hit him. I mean, when the fellow went down, it was a terrible, terrible tackle. I was absolutely sick. And people said, well, you didn't even go back and say you were sorry. I felt hypocritical about that. I couldn't. And for the rest of the game, I never played. I kept out of situations. I never went anywhere. I just got the ball and day out of it, and I didn't accept any responsibility.
Stiles' England career was curtailed by two cartilage operations before the 1970 World Cup tournament in Mexico. He was still included in the squad, but by then Alan Mullery had first claim to that position, and Stiles sat on the bench throughout. Perhaps he'll always be remembered as a purely destructive type of player, but Stiles can point to playing his part in two of the most enduring memories for English football fans. He was a member of the first English team to lift the European Cup and won a World Championship medal as well. Not bad.
I don't think any of us would sit down, talk Sank over and say, now, what's this? Let's sort this problem out. I think you just go in with your aggression and you're on the defensive straight away.
Vinnie Jones is a product of the evolution of the game of football in Britain in the late 80s and early 90s, as the emphasis switches firmly towards strong, athletic and above all physical players. Photographs of Jones and Newcastle United's emerging superstar Paul Gascoigne provided graphic evidence of Vinnie's intimidating style, illustrating that there are more ways than one of coming to grips with talented opponents.
I think seeing in non-league and that, you could definitely get away with it. But now you know, all of a sudden you're in the limelight and everything. That incident was where we had a free kick on our halfway line, and he was just marking me tight, and it was just a little bit of bantering going on between us. I mean, if the truth's known, he was giggling until I went to stand back, and then I trod on his toe, and it shows up on one of the pictures. And I think that's the only bit of pain he got from it.
But Vinnie Jones's career has been littered with moments of madness that have launched his name into the newspaper headlines with great regularity. This incident, a late challenge on Everton's Graham Sharp at Goodison Park, followed by an unnecessary clash with Kevin Ratcliffe, led to one of a series of dismissals. Ratcliffe's reaction to a slight brush of foreheads may be equally reprehensible, but this kind of unsavoury incident, particularly during his early league career, led to Jones becoming an anti-hero on the field, the undisputed leader of Wimbledon's crazy gang.
Obviously, in football, there are things that go on which the spectators don't see and the referee doesn't see. And one of the oldest ones in the book is, you know, going up for the header with the elbow out, giving your opponent a nice lump behind the ear. There's always the poke in the eye when you're not looking, or when the ball's up the other end of the field, the centre-half lays out the centre-forward with a right-hander. The one where you're following a player and he passes the ball off, everybody follows the ball, and then you just come in and follow down with your studs on the back of his Achilles, down the calf. It's always a nice one. And, you know, these sort of things do happen, and it's no good saying they don't. But it's not something that is seen unless you're a little bit cute. There's always the one where you put your opponent down, tackle him very hard, and you go to lift him up, and you put your hands under his armpits and pull his ears, and he's screaming blue murder, and you're just saying to the referee, well, I'm only helping him. Or there's the Gaza one, when they get a bit close to you, you just grab them by the testicles and say, well, can you speak in a bit lower pitch of tone, please? But obviously, there are loads of things that go on. You know, the oldest one in the book is waiting for a corner and sort of treading on everyone's toes on a freezing January day.
Yes, charming. He clearly belongs to the Academy of Intimidation, our Vinnie. And the Plough Lane Crazy Gang confounded pundits for years with their ability to cause upsets wherever they went, turning over the biggest clubs in the land with no respect for surroundings or reputations. And through it all, their style of football remained thoroughly unloved, although widely imitated as the instant route to success. And at the centre of it all, Vinnie Jones, who arrived from non-league Wealdstone. Eventually, the Dons prepared for their most unlikely triumph of all. A mere 11 seasons after reaching the Football League from the Southern League, Wimbledon were at Wembley. Vinnie Jones in direct confrontation with another tough nut, Steve McMahon. And the result, an FA Cup win against the most successful team of the modern era. Not the sort of bloke you want to face in a drop ball situation, that's for sure. After leaving Wimbledon, Vinnie moved to Leeds to help them regain First Division status under the shrewd guidance of Howard Wilkinson. He recognised the positive aspects of having a man like Vinnie in your team, and so did his old boss Dave Bassett, by now at Sheffield United. Playing for United at Manchester City, Vinnie claimed the unofficial world record for the fastest ever booking. A conservative estimate of 4 seconds from the first whistle to his strong challenge on City's Peter Reid, and the referee David Ellery has an early customer in his notebook. Jones's reputation clearly preceded him, but this was another day when a series of rash challenges would lead to his premature departure from the fray. Ideally suited to the physical side of the game now demanded by modern football, Jones has always trodden a fine line between controlled aggression and illegality. This afternoon was another victory for official day. In April 1991, as the Gunners chased their second championship in 3 years, Arsenal's Anders Limpar was another to feel the full force of Vinnie Jones' commitment to the game. And once again, a combination of misdemeanours earned him a few more points on the disciplinary league table. The second challenge was more vigorous than malicious, perhaps. Vinnie blamed the Arsenal boss, George Graham, for his booking, but in truth, he could have few complaints. The next stop in Jones's career, Stamford Bridge, a move from Sheffield United to Chelsea to join up with some of the old Crazy Gang members. And still the Jones enthusiasm teetered on the tightrope of transgression. West Ham's goalkeeper Ludek Miklosko was just one to experience what Jones calls a bit of clump. The pace and passion of the game today dictates that vigorous challenges happen all too often. This time, Crystal Palace's Marco Gabbiadini on the receiving end. And it's no good claiming he came out with the ball, Vinnie. Just look at the same challenge from the alternative angle and you'll see what a two-footed tackle it was. And that's not on. Jones's brief stay at Stamford Bridge produced just 5 goals, but one of them will perhaps give the lie to the suggestion that his game is only about hustling and intimidation. A fine strike which helped produce a memorable 2-1 win at Anfield in February 1992. Nevertheless, Vinnie Jones owes the longevity of his career at top level to the emphasis placed on physical prowess rather than the cultured style of his play. A tough character who always attracts attention, and as his career turns full circle back to the bosom of his first league club, Wimbledon, one suspects that his greatest triumph will always be that fairy tale day at Wembley in May 1988. Another day the Crazy Gang took on the Kop and won.
If you're going to go over the top on me, you've got to put me out of the game. Because I'm going to be coming back for you. Whether it's in the next 5 minutes, the next 10 minutes, or the next game next season.
And that's a promise. Steve McMahon has always managed to balance a combination of the qualities required for top-level success with four major clubs.
Yeah, I mean, Steve McMahon, for me, is probably my only rival when it comes to... See, a lot of things happen in football when we went to the cup final. I mean, you know, there are other tough lads out there. But I think Steve McMahon... Well, I think I'm stronger physically and mentally than Steve McMahon. I think he's a better footballer than me, like, tactically. But mentally and mentally strong and physically strong, I'm a lot tougher than him. And I had to prove that in front of millions of people in the 88 Cup final. As early on as about the seventh minute, I let him just have a touch on the ball and I just whacked him, just hammered him. And it knocked the stuffing out of him. And he went about the field on his tiptoes, you know? And it was a great start. And once, I think in any walks of life, if the top man gets sorted out early doors, I mean, if I was on my own and there's a gang of lads and they're gonna start on me, I would go in and whack the biggest and the toughest straight away. And that's what happened in the cup final. And they were all so shocked that their man had been sorted out. And it spurred on my players to have a go at them. After that, we played up at Anfield and he did have a go at me. He did try and get his revenge. Obviously, it's not something that you show an opponent that you're hurt. You know, 8 stitches in my leg, just below my knee. You know, that's something that he's got to live with in my book. You know, and I think you've got to have character to be, I mean, tough character to be a winner and a leader. And I think he lacks a little bit of that.
Yes, grudging praise for McMahon, who's never been slow in trying to stamp his authority on a game. Merseyside derbies are always contested with such passion that the venom of some of the tackling is bound to overstep the mark. Graham Sharp unhappy on this occasion that McMahon, a former Evertonian, has taken the spirit of the competition a little too far. And neither seem willing candidates for an early reconciliation. McMahon's tenacity in the tackle is his trademark in all senses of the word, and plenty have found his style far too hot to handle. The competitive nature of his game, along with his undoubted but sometimes hidden creative talent, have made him a regular candidate for an England place. 17 caps, though, as his career reaches its twilight, may be poor return. However, he's probably a victim of his own aggression. There have been many occasions when his unrelenting style has caused problems. Coming up, another challenge in a Merseyside derby, which left McMahon himself the injured party, a definite case of the bite a bit.
He's a very competitive player, there isn't any doubt about that. And I think he's seen Souness play quite a lot, and I think he'd like to think at Liverpool he can re-emerge as another Souness, because he's hard-hitting, hard-tackling, works hard in front of the back four, likes possession of the ball, moves all over the park to support players who are in trouble, gets it and gets it into the free positions. But he's also making good forward, pretty adventurous, well-timed runs, getting behind defenders and through players and looking to get into good attacking, strong positions and get amongst the goals. And I've actually seen him score some great goals where, in actual fact, he's actually unlocked the door. You know, he's actually scored the goal to put Liverpool in front.
Inside, he could have a crack. And it! That is a beautiful goal. It really was a lovely goal by Steve McMahon. And McMahon. And he's put that one in beautifully. That's a brilliant goal by Steve McMahon. That's great. From Barnes to McMahon.
The Steve McMahon style is likely to thrive in the current climate, the speed and passion at the very top level of the professional game creating the kind of confrontations, particularly in midfield, that the British football fan craves and which can inevitably lead to misunderstandings with officials. McMahon has been as guilty as many others of his breed of taking things too far. But don't forget, those qualities helped Liverpool to continue their run of unparalleled success and are proof once again, if any were needed, that a truly successful side requires a heart of steel. When McMahon gets it right, there's so much to admire about his game. Perhaps Manchester United's Mark Hughes doesn't agree, and I would think Paul Gascoigne will have lasting memories of his meetings with McMahon. A couple of instances here, perhaps, of the old pro up against the novice when it comes to matters physical. There's no condoning the kind of challenge which left Gazza with a bloody nose. All part of the learning process, though, on the road to stardom.
You know, I've never been... I'd never not want to tackle anyone because of their name. You know? I'd never think, oh, crikey, I can't go into him like full blast here because it's Glenn Hoddle or Gordon Strachan. You know, it doesn't really matter to me who they are. If they're playing against me and they're trying to take my living away.
Next, a man of granite who had great days for Tottenham, Derby and, of course, Scotland throughout the 60s, Dave Mackay. And Mackay is another of our hard men who's been immortalised in a famous photograph, a remarkable snapshot of his frustration with Leeds' Billy Bremner.
Yeah, I mean, I've been in the same situation myself with Paul Gascoigne. And a lot of people say to me, like, that put you on the map, if you like, you know. It was a picture of total commitment and aggression. You know, I mean, they look like, if you'd left them in a ring on their own, you know, one of them would have had to drop down dead to end the fight. You know, they were like two pit bull terriers. For me, I think Dave Mackay was more of a thoroughbred of the early times. You know, I think he could have sort of played in today's football. A lot of people say to me, what's the difference between football then and football now? You know, I think it's a lot more physical and... You know, it's a lot quicker now. But I think he could have coped very quickly. The only thing is, it's like myself sometimes. I get very frustrated, and I'm sure if he played now, I'd get frustrated with the referees because, you know, they just don't give you an inch. You know, and he would probably say the same. I don't think they understand it, you know. It's not life and death. It's more than that.
It's Mackay this time. And a goal!
Dave Mackay, for me, was one of the most charismatic characters and characters, full stop, that I have ever known in the game. He was a great player. He was talked about as a rugged, tough midfield player. But I thought he was definitely one of the best one-touch players that I'd seen.
Mackay was the heart of the Tottenham League and FA Cup double-winning side of 1960-61, the first side this century to achieve such a feat. He managed only four league goals that season, but Bill Nicholson had bought him from Hearts for other reasons.
Mackay was so confident. I mean, he was really superhumanly confident. There are great stories about Dave. I mean, he would...
He would throw the ball to the opposition as he ran out on the field and say, go and have a kick now, because you're not going to get one when the game starts, you know, and all that stuff. And then he would... we used to play in the gym, and Eddie Bailey was the coach then, and he used to give us all a ball each, and there would be lines, coloured lines. There'd be a yellow line, red line, blue, and we'd all have a ball at our feet, and Eddie Bailey would say... Right now, and I'm sure he used to make it out as he went along, he'd say, I want you to chip the ball against the blue line, and as it come up, catch on your thigh and bounce it up on the red line, and then volley it against the yellow one. And as it come up, bump it up on your chest, on your head, volley it up against the white line, and as it come back, kill it dead, you know. And that would all look and say, yeah, terrific, Ed, you know, good. And then Dave, you say, hold on a minute, and he'd go, chip, thigh, volley, back, on the chest, on the head, volley it back on the white line, kill it stone dead. Do you mean that, Ed?
A championship and two FA Cup wins in the early 60s were followed by European glory nights, although Mackay missed the Cup Winners' Cup win in 1963. One interesting thing about him, though, he was never dismissed.
Never ever sent off. I think I was told to go off once, but that was a bit dubious, and the referee changed his mind. But in my whole career, I've never been sent off, which I'm very, very proud of.
Injury, though, interrupted Mackay's career in 1963. A broken leg sustained at Old Trafford. He broke it again in a reserve match before returning to lead Spurs to more glory in the 1967 Cup final against Chelsea. Bill Nicholson described Mackay as the complete professional, the heartbeat of a team with his fierce will to win in every game of every kind.
I mean, people say to me, do players go out to wind you up and get you sent off? I think they've got a lot more sense than that, you know? A lot of people, same as these lads in the video, you've got to be quite a brave lad to wind someone up to the extent of getting them sent off, because, as I say, there's always another day.
Like Billy Bremner, Norman Hunter was at Elland Road throughout the Reevey era. Norman bites your legs, Hunter, as the banner said at Wembley. Another rugged customer.
I think Norman Hunter was on a better sort of atmospheric way of playing football, in the way that he had two other hard men in midfield with him that you was going to rely on. And I think that must be very encouraging, because if you're not going to do it, they're going to get onto you and say, sort yourself out, which needs, in every football match, that's what it needs. If you need to pick someone up, but the art of it is knowing the characters of the other players. It's no good screaming at one player if he can't take that. He might need encouraging. So you've got to know how to get about it. And I think it was a big contest at Leeds with Giles, Hunter and Bremner to be the toughest. But, I mean, I'd love to have played like that with two other lads that were very messy, as we say.
When he says messy, he means that if Hunter missed a tackle, it was obvious for all to see. Examples coming up of what appear to be bad cases of mistimed challenges rather than deliberately malicious attempts to injure an opponent. That one was on Vic Hallam in the 1973 Cup final. Next on the receiving end, Alan Ball, also in a Wembley Cup final. This one was rash enough to earn a place in the referee's book. Chelsea's Steve Kember got nailed by the unrushing Hunter as well, but he knows the difference between a friendly tap and a savage foul. Hunter also had his moments in an England shirt. This one was none too pleasant, but he was restricted to 28 caps by the brilliance in his position of a certain Bobby Moore. Hunter was in fact a member of the shadow World Cup winning squad of 1966, and his talents had many admirers.
I want Norman Hunter in there because I feel that the Poles will want pressurising. I want Norman Hunter there for his strength, and I'll show you exactly what I mean by Norman Hunter in midfield.
Yes, old Cluffy knew there was more to Norman Hunter's game than just misjudging the odd tackle. This little montage is quite surprising evidence of how good a footballer Hunter was. Come on, Dennis Chewett, he couldn't get it right all the time. And actually, there was one rather nasty moment in that 1973 Cup final against Sunderland when Norm arrived a little later than expected. But his old boss, Don Reavy, was well aware of the strength that Norman Hunter brought to that dominant lead side of the 60s and early 70s.
Every team had its hard minute, you know, Nobby Stiles, Tommy Smith at Liverpool, Dave Mackay at Tottenham, and we had Norman Hunter. But I don't think we had any harder men in our team than a lot of the other First Division teams. I think we had players who could play when it mattered, and they could play hard when it mattered.
Hunter was voted PFA Player of the Year in 1974 by his fellow professionals, the first ever winner of that award. And he was known for his reliance on his left foot. Coming up, though, a beauty of a goal at West Ham, remarkable for the fact that it was struck with his right. And now one of his two goals for England, this one against Wales with his more conventional left foot.
Bell. This time it's Hunter. That left foot. And he left spring goal.
Norman Hunter, one of the unluckiest players in the world for me, Norman Hunter. Because he was a lad that missed only 10 matches in 10 years for me. And you got the same performance at the Norman Hunter for 42 matches a season. He never used to drop his performance. It was always a level of about 85% every week, every year, for 10 years. He could read the game well. Didn't get the credit for the skill he had. Great left foot. He'd get in behind Terry Cook and chop it off and knock it up to Eddie Gray or Billy Brandner or Johnny Giles and say, go on, go at them. And he would sweep up behind Jack and everybody and just did his job nice and quietly.
And up goes Charlie Cook. And in goes Hunter like a tank.
As we've seen, old Bites Your Legs always let the opposition know he was around. But despite his lapses, he was a member of the first Leeds team to win the league, the FA Cup, the League Cup and the Intercities Fairs Cup. His career ended with a highly impressive list of credits.
I think English football likes goals. Goals, winning, the goals, and the passion to play for your club.
And they don't come any more passionate for club or country than Brian Robson, a man with as much desire as any player of the modern era.
When Robson plays football, he must expect to get hurt, because that's him. When he sees a ball, irrespective of where it is, on a football field, he automatically goes for it. Now, afterwards, he sometimes says, I don't really know why I went for it. And he'd be asking that when he's laying in the treatment room. But that is Robson. And that's the end of the story with him.
Brian Robson has been putting himself about in Manchester United's midfield to great effect ever since Ron Atkinson bought him from West Bromwich Albion in 1981. He's been a tremendous competitor, widely acknowledged for his bravery and determination. The only drawback, as Cluffy says, he's just about the most injury-prone player in the country. No shortage of praise, though, from the boss, Alec Ferguson.
And I can't think of anyone that in the last 15 years at this club who's been a greater player than Brian Robson. People assessing him say, what's his great strength? I mean, I think it's a marvellous courage. I think his ability to score goals as a midfield player in the modern game makes him outstanding in itself. But I think looking at him, he has a quality that you can't coach in players, really, and that is timing. When two lads go up for a ball in a red jersey and another one's jersey, Brian knows what's going to land. When a ball's coming in the back post, he knows it needs to be there. If it's going in the front post when we're attacking, he knows it has to be there. And he just has this talent to time things and being at the right place at the right time. And apart from the courage and his influence in our team, a great experience to have him as a player.
In contrast to many of his contemporary midfielders, Robson's positive qualities have always been to the fore for both club and country. He's been an inspirational figure. Although, frustratingly, a league championship victory has always eluded him. He's never needed to resort to some of the sneakier tactics employed by others. His latent ability has carried him through. That's not to say that he's not a match for any player in the heat of battle, just that he doesn't go looking for trouble. And in the bustle of the big time, there are plenty of situations that could end up distastefully. With Robson, he commands a bit of respect and often finishes with a handshake or a smile. Even nearing the end of his playing career, Robson is one of the most committed players around. His 12 years with England produced 90 caps and 26 goals, many of them of crucial importance to the cause. A curious fact, though, for such a charismatic character, he's never once been voted either PFA Players' Player of the Year or won the Football Writers' equivalent of the award. No doubt the catalogue of injuries that he's suffered at the hands of opponents and as a result of sheer bad luck has been responsible for his missing out on many top occasions. According to Cluffy, his fearless nature has been both a blessing and a hindrance.
Now, if Robson had known fear, he wouldn't get hurt so much. But he doesn't know it. It's something which you can't put into them, and something which you never want to knock out of them.
Brian Robson, the eighth of our hard men, who served Manchester United and England with such distinction for so long, by Alex Ferguson's admission, the best player at Old Trafford over the last 15 years, and one who'll fully deserve his place in United's Hall of Fame, alongside the Laws, the Bests, and the Charltons. His only regret, that he could fail to deliver the first league championship to United since that era, and therefore leave his final list of achievements sadly lacking.
I think it's more a battle of character if you get two tough lads in a game. I want to show my lads that I'm a tough lad. I've got it all sorted out. There's nothing to worry about there. And obviously they're doing the same thing.
Now a third member of that great Leeds side and another of the 1966 World Cup winning squad, Jack Charlton, whose playing career was all spent at Elland Road.
We got to Jack Charlton. I think he summed it up a year or 2 years ago for me when they said about an Englishman being in charge of the Irish team. And he promptly turned around and said, it's not about your race, your religion, it's about people. Life is about people. And for him to go and do the Irish job, he proved that. You know, he's a big fella. Super in the air. I think he was a lot tougher in the air and so on the floor. But, you know, strutted about like the rooster in the chicken run. You knew he was there. Wherever he was over the pitch, you didn't want him coming in behind you trying to get the ball off you. And I think he ambassadored the Leeds United from the back, and I think it crept through right up to Peter Lorimer up front.
Defensively, Big Jack was a tower of strength, and in attacking situations, getting under the bar and getting goals from us for corner kicks and things like that. But he used to read the game well, tremendous in the air, would play with all kind of injuries for you, and went on to get all the things he deserved, including the World Cup wins medal in 66.
And if I was picking a World Cup side, and if I was picking the best ever side, I'd pick Jackie Charlton after 26-27. He learned his trade more than I've ever known anybody. 21, you could stick it through his legs, and stick it in the back of the net, and he would be looking round to see whose fault it was. But when he got to 26-27, he knew his trade, he knew his job, and I must say that only one man could have taught him his trade, Don Revie. Nobody else could have taught him his trade. And suddenly he became, among centre-forwards, he was a guy that you didn't mind playing against. I never minded playing against him. His record, goal-scoring, was good. But under Revie, he became a centre-half, and possibly the best in Europe And if I was going to pick a centre-half to get me through a championship, I'd stick him alongside Roy McFarlane.
Right in. And I hit him on a bloody heel and went past the ball down. I did. When I hit it, I thought it was wrong.
The ball was in all good, Harry. And Gary kicked it and went home and put it down.
I remember once asking him how he picked the team, how he decided on the team, how did he decide how to play? And he said, well, really the question was, I said, and why did you pick me? Because at that time I was 28. And Alf said, well, he said, you're good in the air, you're mobile, you're a good tackler. And he said, and you fit the pattern that I have in my mind, in the way I want the team to play. In other words, he didn't pick the best players, and he always admitted he never picked the best players at the time. He picked the people to fit the pattern of the game that he wanted us to play, which I think is a very sensible way of picking a team, particularly a national side, that if you've got a basic plan, it's no good picking somebody who doesn't fit the basic plan. You pick somebody who does.
Head down. He's head down.
He's a very knowledgeable player in terms of football. He's willing to talk football 24 hours a day. And again, on similar lines to Nobby Stiles, he's willing to muck in.
Charlton. Charlton now going through, and eventually got a penalty, and it's in the net!
As a player with Leeds United, Jack Charlton finished his league career with 70 goals, far more than the average centre-half, and 20 years at Elland Road brought Big Jack just about all the game had to offer, as his career details prove.
I've only been in football 5 years. I came in at 21. And when you're 21, you're supposed to be a man, you know? And I've lived for 21 years trying to scrape through life. And when, you know, I used to open pray to be a footballer. Not in the first division, maybe not. Maybe in the fourth division. But when I got the chance, and like now, I mean, I'd never overlook it, that fact. And that's why I can relate to the crowd. I know what they're going through, because it was only 5 years ago when I was stood on them terraces with them. I know what they expect, I know what I expected. So I know what to give them when I'm out there. And it doesn't always have to be the bad things. It doesn't have to always be, you know, the elbow off the ball or the bad tackle. It can be in relation to having a giggle with them. You know, being a character. I think most of the hard men in football have been characters as well. And a lot of the good players, i.e. Paul Gascoigne, is a great character for football. You know?
From the antics of Gazza to the archetypal hard man, Tommy Smith of Liverpool, surprisingly capped only once by England.
Tommy Smith, I would put him in the class of the minute he got off the coach and walked in the changing room, I think people would go for cover. I mean, he was one of these sort of the big ugly man, you know, the big ferocious looking bloke that, you know, if someone said to you that he breathed fire, you'd believe him. You know, he had legs like tree trunk sort of thing, you know, massive legs. He had big, thick set body, you know. And, you know, I mean, if you had him on your side, I'm sure he could inspire anybody. And he did, you know. I mean, I've seen him at Liverpool in the players' lounge. Even now, he still looks a beast of a man. But, you know, it'd have been nice to have a battle against him.
Tommy Smith was a youngster, fresh into the team, when Liverpool's reign of success was gathering pace under Bill Shankly in 1965. The first signs of his promise in the cup final against Leeds.
Smith, what a fine young player he is. This is his first season, the big time.
Colin, Story. So you've got to be double quick off the mark. Story beat by Smith.
Still in play now. Hannison.
Well, very little has gone past Tom Smith this afternoon. Easily beaten by Smith. Smith been an outstanding player, I would say, in today's match. Bremner beaten by Smith.
So, a telling part in Liverpool's success that day, just the start for a firm Anfield favourite.
Great character, Tommy. Marvellous boy. You know, his bark, far worse than his bite. But the Anfield Iron was his nickname from the cop. And he was hard, Tommy. But fair, I always thought fair. Problem was, he would always talk to referees and linesmen and get any more trouble with his tongue, really, than with his tackling. But he was also a very talented player, Tommy. You could win the ball, great winner of the ball, obviously.
Smith was in hard against Kennedy. Beaten by Smith, who's so powerful in those tackles. Smith misjudged it. This wind is a little bit awkward, but he played out his way out of trouble with all the experience that he possesses after 12 senior years with Liverpool. Looking at a famous profile, I'm reminded of a player's words, an opponent's words, when he said, Tommy Smith doesn't look as if he was born, he looks as if he was quarried. He's certainly a hard man. Beautiful ball to Smith. He didn't have to move to get it. Ball to Smith. Highway, Liverpool showing the party pieces. He wasn't offside. Smith, yes! Keegan second! And Newcastle were absolutely stripped naked. And Tommy Smith again. He's had two tremendous matches. Look at the ball to Fairclough. And Smith read it so well. Ball for Toshak, who let it go. Fairclough! Started from Tommy Smith's reading of Brian Flynn's intentions. Built up the move on the right, and then John Toshak had the nous to let it go. And there was David Fairclough for his second goal of the match. Dobson.
So, our first indication that Tommy Smith wasn't all deft touches and probing passes. Clive the Book Thomas did have cause to enter Smith's name in his autograph book on the odd occasion. This particular instance, it seems more than justified, despite the protests. And once again, you don't make 467 appearances for Liverpool without being able to take a few out when the situation demands.
Tommy Smith's tackle that quite rightly gets the booking.
Yes, I don't think there was any doubt that the ball had gone well before Alan Clark was clobbered around the ankles. And similarly, when Colin Bell took a tumble at Main Road in the next clip, it's pretty clear that Tommy was as good as any at arriving slightly late. And if there was any pushing and shoving to be done, Tommy was happy to be in the thick of it. And he did a mean routine with the finger pointing as well. By the way, have you spotted the referee? Yep, it's old Clive the Book again. A coincidence though, surely. Amazing how those Merseyside derbies bring out the worst in people's characters, although I suspect a spot of retribution was being dished out here.
Smith was powering his way out of defence. It was a good piece of play from him, and Buckley just brought him crashing down. Not often this mountain of a man is down like that. Better away by Bonds. Smith.
And who will forget his goal in Rome now? I was delighted that Tommy Smith scored in that cup final because nobody deserves it any more than Tommy to score a goal in the European Cup final. And a marvellous header it was.
Oh yes! And what a delighted scorer! It's Tommy Smith! Look at it again! Oh, what an end to a career!
Sure was. Five league championship medals for Tommy Smith, but strangely, just that solitary England cap.
When you do get that situation with the 40-60 ball, you know, someone is going to get a clatter. I mean, the good thing about English football, they don't roll about the length of the pitch if they're not hurt. But, you know, I hope, like the continental football, fouls and their antics don't creep into our football because people like myself will be finished.
Aha! At last, a hard man with a name to match, Ron Harris, known to all who crossed his path as Chopper.
Yeah, Ron Harris. It's funny they called him Ron Chopper Harris. And that was more like my first nickname when I went to Wimbledon, Vinnie Chopper Jones. I think it just come from the Chopper Harris, you know, beforehand. And so I think the crowd was looking to give me my own nickname. And they come up with Psycho, you know, for me. But doesn't matter what they're going to call you. I mean, people like Chopper Harris just walked about with something that people wanted and didn't know what it was.
And Harris really showing why he's got a hard man, not flinching at all.
George Best knew what it was all right, and it's to his immense credit that he rode it. Chopper Harris was a legend at the Bridge. Chelsea fans loved him, but what was the attraction?
It was arrogance, terror. You name it, then people turned up to see it. They paid to see it. Week in, week out.
Harris to get close to Grave.
In the 1970 FA Cup final at Wembley, Leeds' Eddie Gray tormented David Webb, but in the replay at Old Trafford, Chelsea put Harris on him. Generally speaking, skill prevails in situations like these, but Chopper had the last laugh that night. He was the first, and to date the only, Chelsea captain ever to lift the FA Cup. Chopper Harris's Stamford Bridge career continued until the end of the 70s. He terrorised wingers like Arsenal's George Armstrong in more than 650 league matches, and he was never less than fully committed. It didn't do to turn your back on old Chopper, as Ray Kennedy found out to his discomfort. And although never a regular goal scorer, the old gem did find its way onto the screens of Match of the Day.
Harris!
by Ron Harris.
A European Cup Winners' Cup win in Athens in 1971 was another highlight for Ron Harris, one of the three major triumphs of his career.
I think if you look at any of the lads in this video, and you look, say, at the war, the lad that carried the flag or the emblem of the club or the country, if that lad got shot, then any of these lads in the video, I think you'd bank on them. You wouldn't even need to turn around to see who's running with the flag.
Running with the flag for Arsenal is the final member of our elite club of hard men, Peter Storey, a double winner with the Gunners in 1970-71. Storey was the bogeyman to a whole generation of top strikers, and his contribution to the Arsenal team, which became only the third side in football history to take the League and Cup double, can't be overestimated. He was one of the few members of that team to become an established international, gaining 19 England caps between 1970 and 73. Storey helped form the backbone of that double side, which, although never acknowledged for its pure ability, was resilient and tough. Storey was beset by personal problems years later, but by contrast off the field, he was known as the quiet member of that highly successful Arsenal team.
Lorimer, Hartford, foul by Storey. Hartford exacted retribution, but he's got the free kick.
He was never known as a regular goal scorer, but Storey produced two of the most dramatic in the double season, a couple to bring Arsenal back level with Stoke in the FA Cup semi-final and keep their double dream alive.
I'm definitely the opposite to a Gary Lineker, because Gary Lineker's never been booked. So where's, you know, to me, the passion and your urgency and your enthusiasm must lead you into areas where you're going to cause some problems. And it's the same old story. Would you want Gary Lineker in the trenches with you, or would you want Vinnie Jones in your trenches with you? You know? Because at the end of the day, Vinnie Jones will get out of the trench and run towards the enemy. Whereas I think, you know, Gary Lineker would sit in the trench and say, after you.
The authorities have stamped out the worst tackles. This awful challenge by Bobby Collins on Jerry Byrne in the 1965 FA Cup final would never be tolerated today. But challenges on the goalkeepers have been the major change. This incident dominated the 1957 FA Cup final between Manchester United and Aston Villa. Peter McParland is the Villa forward charging in on Ray Wood, the United keeper, and he clearly intends to make contact. Ray Wood suffered a broken cheekbone and McParland received no caution for this disgraceful challenge. In the following year, and at the same place, Bolton's Nat Lofthouse bundled another Manchester United goalkeeper over, this time into the net to score a goal. Harry Gregg is the recipient of another brutal assault as Lofthouse charges in to batter him over the line. It was hardly surprising that as a direct result of the FA Cup finals of 57 and 58, goalkeepers were to become protected. Indeed, by 1968 and the League Cup final, a challenge on goalkeeper Gary Sprake incensed Leeds so much that fighting broke out. And by 1973, in the historic Leeds-Sunderland final, it was made very clear to forwards that deliberate charges on goalkeepers wouldn't be tolerated. Here, Alan Clark clearly follows in on Jim Montgomery after the ball has been collected and is rightly penalised. In the same game, this Lofthouse-like challenge on David Harvey was now definitely illegal, and the rules had been clearly defined to give goalkeepers more protection. Some feel too much. Vinnie Jones, though, feels he has his own style of intimidation to counteract these regulations.
You've got to wind them up. I mean, the verbals are the biggest thing in football at the moment. You know, if you see something in the paper, say, like, a player's wife's run off with someone or something like that, you always remind them about that, you know. But as they say, it's a funny old game.